Our work of recording. So I explain this to you. I hope you are able to understand. If for some reason you don't like this explanation, I will try to give one more explanation to you. Okay. So I will try to give one more explanation to you. Look, this is the solvent. Okay. And this is the solvent in vapor phase. This is solvent. This is solvent in vapor phase. Suppose S is the entropy here. S1 is the entropy here. S2 is the entropy here. Do you understand that delta S, when the solvent is becoming a vapor, is S2 minus S1? This is equal to delta S is equal to S2 minus S1. Now, you know delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. Now, at boiling, the whole system is in equilibrium. So, delta G is equal to zero. So, you have delta H is equal to T delta S. Yeah? Do you understand this? Delta H is equal to T delta S. Now, the solution, if you talk of solution, its entropy will be more than that of solvent. So, it will be S2. So, when you talk about delta S now, do you see that you are talking about a reduced delta S? So, if you are talking about a reduced delta S, do you understand increase for delta H to be the same? Yeah. So, do you understand that there's elevation, the temperature has increased? What temperature has increased? The boiling temperature has increased. Yeah, the boiling temperature has increased. So, do you understand that that is nothing but the elevation in boiling point that we are talking of? Yes, can you think about it a little? I'm saying S1 is the entropy of the solid, whatever it, of the solute solvent, whatever it is. S2 is the entropy of the solvent in the vapor phase, whatever it is. So delta S that we are going to talk of is S2 minus S1. Delta S is equal to S2 minus S1. So if delta S is equal to S2 minus S1, I can now write that delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. Now, if delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S, now the entropy of the solution will be more than that of the solvent, but much, much, much less than that in the vapor phase. So now the delta S that we're talking of is moving from here to here. So the delta S has kind of decreased. So if delta S has decreased, T must increase for delta H to be the same. So T is increased means the boiling point has increased. So we have explained the elevation in boiling point by using the concepts of entropy. Is this understood? Yeah, we are doing chemistry again. I just want to finish up this weekend. You have full chapter. As far as physics is concerned, we are ahead. Not a problem. Yeah. Oh, get back, friends. Get back. Have you understood this or no? Yeah. It is positive delta S. This is the pure solvent. Liquid phase. This is vapor phase of solvent. This is the vapor phase of solvent. This has an entropy S1, absolute entropy S1. This has an absolute entropy S2. Because this is entropy is the amount of disorderness. Solids are less disorderly than liquids. Liquids are less disorderly than than gases. So gases have maximum entropy followed by liquids, followed by solids. So here I have written down the entropy of this and this. Okay. Then I am further telling that pure substances have lower entropy than impure substances. So, somewhere here is the entropy of the solution, which is A plus B. Because it is impure, its entropy is here. Now, boiling. Boiling refers to a situation where a liquid and its vapor phase are in equilibrium, where a liquid and its vapor phase are in equilibrium. So if a liquid phase and its vapor phase are in equilibrium, that means we are, suppose you're talking about boiling process, delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. For any situation which is in equilibrium, delta G is equal to zero. So you have delta H minus T delta S is equal to zero. So you have delta H is equal to T delta S. So necessarily boiling is an endothermic process where heat has to be supplied. Boiling is an endothermic process where heat has to be supplied. Yeah. Now in the first case, you are going from here to here. So delta S is, we will call this S3. Delta S, initially delta S is equal to S3 minus S1. Finally, delta S2 is equal to S3 minus S2. So delta H, for a liquid to go to its vapor state, the energy is same. The enthalpy is going to be the same. And that will become equal to T delta S. So now I can write T1 delta S1 must be equal to T2 delta S2. So from this, because delta S2 is less than delta S1, I have T2 is greater than T1. So that refers to an elevation. Elevation means increase in the boiling temperature. So the temperature at which it boils will now have a much at which it will boil will be much higher than what it was before. So this is what is referred to as elevation in boiling point. Can't express it better words than this. So that's it. There's nothing more that I have to say about this. So there was a question which came in a JE mains once where this was there. But otherwise, for board, whatever we read so far is more than enough. Why are we relating the elevation of boiling point to molality and not to the mole fraction? We can relate it to the mole fraction. They found out all those constants for molality.
you can find out those constants for mole fraction. Mole fraction will be very less because mole fraction will be very less. So they did not, because these are solids are not very highly soluble in water. So they are very limited amount of solubility. So if you take 1 kilogram of, they took molality because they wanted, they're talking about changing temperature. So they wanted something which has no, which is not influenced by temperature. So the options were mole fraction and molality. Now between the two, mole fraction will be a very small number. So they found out the constant for a higher number. And then they wanted that number to be higher. So they considered molality. Okay. Yeah, so Levin, I hope I have answered your question. Then Yashika, I also hope I have answered your question. Then, yes. Any other questions you all have? I will explain again the elevation and boiling point. Now, this is the vapor pressure. This is the temperature. As temperature goes, vapor pressure increases. This is what we have learnt. This is for a pure solvent. Pure solvent. Now, vapor pressure is 1 atmosphere. So, this is the boiling point, TB. Yeah. Now, when you have a solution, the vapor pressure is less at that given temperature. So, each value, it will be less. So, this is the vapor pressure diagram at a lower temperature. Sorry, for a solution. For a solution. Now, same 1 atmosphere pressure is the boiling. So, now this is the new boiling point, TB1. So, the elevation in boiling point, is equal to TB1 minus TB. And that is proportional to molality. And that is equal to KB into molality. KB for the ebullioscopic constant, EBULLIOSCOPIC, ebullioscopic constant. And I explained to you why molality, because they wanted a term which is independent of temperature, because as temperature changes, most other terms will change. Mole fraction was one, but that number would be very less. So we are taking molality. Yeah. Now, technically, molality is equal to mass of solute by molar mass of solute divided by weight of solvent by 1000. So, in the numerator, 1000 will come. So, this is equal to KB into M. Sorry, this into KB is equal to delta TB. So from here, I can now calculate whatever I want to calculate. Mostly this is used to determine the molar mass of unknown solids. So I can do some small rearrangement and get it. So one, I can rearrange it and say that delta TB is equal to KB into mass of solute into 1000 divided by molar mass of solute into mass of solvent. From here, I can say that molar mass is equal to KB into W2 into 1000, depending on what is given, by delta TB into W1. So, depending on what is given, I can now find this out. So this is an experiment that is used to determine the molar mass of unknown solids. So this also depends upon the vapor pressure, because it depends upon the vapor pressure. It continues to be a part of the colligative properties. Yeah. Okay. Yes. Any other option? Any other questions? Yes. Is this understood? Yes, my dear students, there are so many of you all. Please say something. Yes, no. Okay, so if you all understood this, then one question for you all. 18 grams of glucose, C6H12O6, is dissolved in 500 grams of water at what temperature, will it boil? At 1.013 atmosphere pressure, if KB is equal to 0.52 Kelvin kg per mole. 0.52 Kelvin kg per mole. 18 grams of glucose is dissolved in 500 grams of water. So totally in 1 kilogram of water, you will have 18 plus 18. That is 36 grams. Molar mass of glucose, 12 into 6. Is like 72 plus 12 plus 16 into 6 is some 96. So this is like 180. So moles of glucose is equal to 36 by 180. That is 1 by 5, 0.2. So it is so many molar. So I can now answer delta TB is equal to KB into molality. So that will be KB 0.52 into 0.2. So 0.52 into 0.2 is 0.104. Yeah. So instead of boiling at 373 Kelvin, now it will boil at 373.104 Kelvin. Yes, are we able to understand this? Yes, are we able to understand this? Okay, good. So if you understand this, then let me move ahead. The next is depression in freezing point. So this is the vapor pressure of a solute, of the solution, solvent, vapor pressure of pure solvent. This is the vapor pressure in the solid state, that is above the solid state. So this is for the vapor pressure in the solid state. Now at this temperature, the liquid, solid, and gas are coexisting. That is the definition of freezing. Freezing point is that temperature. Is that temperature at which solid phase, liquid phase, and vapor phase coexist? It's the highest temperature at which all three coexist. So, this is that temperature. So, this is how the vapor pressure changes. This is the frozen solvent. This is the liquid. Now, the vapor pressure of the solution is something like this. So again, for this line to meet the solid line, it will have to be traced back. So this is the point where it is meeting. So this is the original freezing point and this is the new freezing point. So you see that there is a depression in freezing point. So there is a lowering. There is a lowering in freezing point. Lowering in freezing temperature of a solution. So this lowering is also proportional to the molality and is equal to a new constant Kf into molality. This Kf is referred to as the cryoscopic, cryoscopic, cryoscopic constant. So there you had ebullioscopic constant, here you have cryoscopic constant. So I hope I'm able to explain to you the delta Tf. I'll repeat again. This is the vapor pressure of the vapor pressure of pure solvent above liquid. This is the vapor pressure above frozen solvent. So there is a point here where these two curves are meeting. So that is referring to the freezing point of a solvent. Now this is the vapor pressure of the solution. So this goes this way. So now that meeting point is here. So this is the freezing point of solution. This is for solvent. So there is a lowering. There is a lowering in freezing point. So this lowering in freezing point is proportional to molality. This lowering in freezing point is equal to Kf into molality. So that is what we are trying to say. So there is an elevation in boiling point. So when you go to hill climates, you don't boil the water just like that. You add salt so that the boiling point increases. Then similarly, suppose it snows. You add salt to it. You add salt to it so that the boiling point decreases so that the snow will start melting. Okay, so elevation in boiling point, lowering in freezing point. These are again two colligative properties. Both depend upon the molality. One is equal to KB into M, one is equal to KF into M. Ebullioscopic constant, cryoscopic constant. Everything else is the same. So 0 degrees centigrade for water is all the three squares. States click state. All the states coexist. Certainly here number of moles. You're talking about the problem. If thinking of problem, we are mistaken. Has grams 8 grams of glucose in 100 grams of water. 1000 grams of water, it will be 30 grams. That is what I have taken. So 36 by 180, to my knowledge, is 1/5. 1/5 is like 0.2. Okay, so there is no error in this. Correct. What I have done is. It's an observation depression in the freezing point. Maybe if we look at our entropy, this is the entropy of pure solvent. This is the entropy of solution. This is entropy of liquid of solid state. So again, delta G is equal to delta H minus delta S. So I'll get H equal to delta S. Yeah. Now, condensation, we are talking about freezing, right? We are talking about freezing. So condensation is an exothermic process. So delta H is negative. So delta H is negative. Very clear. Delta S is also negative. Is also negative. Yeah. So I can say delta H1 is equal to T into delta S1. So this is the freezing temperature. Now delta H2 is equal to T freezing temperature into delta S2. So delta S2 means what? So delta S1 is going to be, this time delta S1 is negative. Okay, delta S1 is negative. Delta S2 is more negative. Delta S2 is more negative. Okay, I will think about this. This is too, the logic will still work out. Only thing is you have to look at the numbers and then see.
Okay, so I am not able to answer why it decreases, but that is the explanation that I can give. So Vaibhav, that's the best I can say. Why it decreases, I can say from the vapor pressure. From entropy, if you can think, you may be able to say. Yes, any other questions? Basically, delta S1 is lesser. Delta S1 is lesser. So this is, sorry, delta S2 is lesser. So T will be greater. Here, delta S1 is greater. So T will be lesser. So anyway, forget it. Let me think about it and then I'll get back. So, yes. Any other questions you all have? Yeah, so if you understand that, that is it. So there is an elevation in boiling point. There is a depression in freezing point. So the depression in freezing point, elevation in boiling point is proportional to the molar, to the Kf and Kb values. Actually, these Kf, Kb values are also not constants. They also keep changing with temperature. Kf and Kb also changes with temperature. So Kf is equal to R into M1 into Tf squared divided by 1000 into delta H fusion. R is gas constant. M1 is the molar mass of solvent. Molar mass of solvent. Tf is the freezing point. Similarly, Kb also depends upon R into M1 into Tb squared divided by 1000 into delta H vaporization. Kb and Kf depend upon the nature of the solvent. So it is different for each different solvents. So these two formulas are to be remembered, especially for entrance exams. Yeah. Is this understood? This is, you have to remember these formulas. There is nothing more I can do. Not many logics that I can say as far as this is concerned. Okay. Now, there is just one more colligative property that we have to learn. That is osmotic pressure. Okay. That is known as osmotic pressure. So, we just need to understand osmotic pressure. So before that, we need to understand what is osmosis. Osmosis is a process by which a liquid moves from a region of its higher concentration to a region of its lower concentration through a semi-permeable membrane.
bio students will know this quite well, through a semi-permeable membrane. That means you have a container here, you have a liquid here, you have a dilute solution here, you have a concentrated solution here. So the liquid flows from dilute solution to concentrated solution. So this flow is basically referred to as osmosis. Now, if I apply a pressure here, I can stop this flow. So that pressure that I need to apply to stop this flow is what is known as osmotic pressure. Okay, so that pressure which has to be applied to stop osmosis through a semi-permeable membrane is what is referred to as osmotic pressure. And osmotic pressure is basically represented as pi, and pi is equal to CRT. You would have read PV is equal to NRT. PV equals NRT. So P is equal to N by V RT. So this N by V is nothing but concentration. So you have pi is equal to CRT. C for concentration, R this. Now here we are not talking about temperature. So we can talk about concentration in terms of moles per liter. So the osmotic pressure developed in a solution is simply equal to CRT. C for concentration, R for universal gas constant, and T for temperature. Now, if you are finding out pressure in atmospheres, it is 0.0831 liter atmosphere per mole per Kelvin. If you are finding out pressure in SI units, accordingly, it will change, but you will mostly be finding out in atmospheres. So, R value is equal to 0.0831 liter atmosphere per mole per Kelvin. Yeah, liter atmosphere per mole per Kelvin. Yes. So this process of flow of the solvent is called osmosis. Osmosis means, suppose you have suppose you take a potato and you add some salt to make a cavity and put some salt in it. After some time, you will see that lot of water comes from within the cells outside. Pickling, we are doing, whatever happens in pickling is osmosis. Now, in your water filter, you have reverse osmosis. That means from a already dirty solution, you are taking out the water. From a concentrated solution, you are taking out the water. So that is reverse osmosis. For reverse osmosis to happen, you have to apply a greater pressure here so that the water starts flowing in the opposite direction. Okay, so semi-permeable membrane means it's a membrane which will allow liquid to flow only from one direction and not from the other direction. Is this understood? Okay, so there is a doubt that you will have lower concentration to higher concentration. It's all a matter of English. I am saying the solvent moves from a region, R-E-G-I-O-N, region of its higher concentration. Its higher concentration to a region of its lower concentration. So it's lower concentration. So it's higher concentration means this is a dilute solution. It's lower this is higher concentration means it's a dilute solution. It's lower concentration means it's a more concentrated solution. We are talking about high concentration of solute and high concentration of solvent. So if you are talking about its higher concentration, you mean higher concentration of solvent. So a dilute solution, D-I-L-U-T-E, dilute solution has higher concentration of solvent. Similarly, a concentrated solution has lower concentration of solvent. So you can replace this higher concentration from a region of a dilute solution to a region of a concentrated solution. So you can remove and interchange those. Then it just becomes the opposite sense. So this word it's here is what makes the difference. So what you're saying is true, that the solvent molecules move from lower concentration to higher concentration. So they are talking about the solution, lower concentrated solution, higher concentrated solution. So higher concentration is lower concentration of solvent. Lower concentration is higher concentration of solvent. So what I am saying is also correct. Yes. Okay, so I will just explain those slides to you once again, or first show you those slides so that you can make notes, and then I will explain. So this is the variation of KF and KB for a solvent. It depends upon its temperature. It depends upon its molar mass. Then the next slide that I showed you is about osmotic pressure, that every solution exerts an osmotic pressure. So osmotic pressure, first we need to understand what is osmosis. Osmosis refers to a process in which a liquid moves from a region of from a low concentration to a high concentration. That is, we are talking about one solution which is having a low concentration. We are talking about another solution which is having a high concentration. So suppose you dig a cavity in potato, and in that cavity you put some salt. If you put some salt, then what happens is salt is high concentration. Yeah. So now water moves from within the cells to outside. Okay, so that is what is happening. So if you have a container, in this container, suppose here you have a solution, and this side you have solvent, and you have a semi-permeable membrane, the solvent particles will move towards the solution. Now, if you apply a pressure here, this liquid will exert a pressure and it will stop this flow. So that external pressure which stops the flow of the liquid altogether is what is referred to as osmotic pressure. That external force which will stop the movement of the liquid flow from the solvent side to the solution side is what is known as osmotic pressure. And in this case, osmotic pressure pi is equal to CRT, where C is the concentration in moles per liter. That is, it is the molarity of the solution. Okay, molarity of the solution. So these are the four colligative properties that you have to know. The first colligative property is the relative lowering in vapor pressure. First one is the relative lowering in vapor pressure. The second one is elevation in boiling point. Next one is depression in freezing point. And the fourth one is osmotic pressure. All these are Colligative properties. Colligative properties means they depend only upon the number of solute particles and nothing else. They depend only on the number of solute particles and nothing else. So, if you take sugar, C6H12O6, sugar basically breaks into smaller particles, and these particles go and sit in the intermolecular spaces. Okay, and that is what is solubility. But on the other hand, if you take NaCl, electrovalent compounds, this forms Na plus aqueous and Cl minus aqueous, and this is how the solubility is defined. So here the number of particles is equal to, or is proportional to moles, I can work out. But in this particular case, it need not be the case because it also depends upon the degree of dissociation. So here, the in such cases, the number of power, suppose you add something like AlCl3. So this will form Al plus plus 3Cl minus. So you are thinking you have added one particle, but you have added four particles. So if a property depends upon the number of particles, then what this will change? Yeah, so number of particles here have changed. So this will show abnormal colligative property. So this is that portion which has been deleted for you. So there is a portion deleted for you called Wenthoff factor. That is abnormal colligative properties, formation of abnormal colligative properties. So this is what is abnormal colligative properties are all about. The actual number of particles in solution and number of particles added are not the same. Happens because of dissociation. So abnormal properties are seen mostly in electrovalent compounds and not in covalent compounds. So here you will not see any abnormality, but here you will see abnormality. Okay. So we won't talk about this today. We don't need it now. So I am done. Tomorrow we will have our both physics class, chemistry class separate. In physics class, we will continue with our work. In chemistry, we will only do more numericals on whatever we are learning. Okay. So I hope you all try to work out. Only if you read, you will get it. This is easy and interesting both. So all these I explained to you. Elevation and boiling point, I explained to you. Yeah, so depression and freezing point, I explained to you. So the depression and freezing point is directly proportional to the molality. Why molality? Because we are talking about temperature change, so we don't want to use molarity. So this is how Kf and Kb change with temperature. Osmotic pressure pi is equal to CRT. Concentration is in moles per liter. Talking about osmosis, what is osmosis? Dilute solution, concentrated solution, it's a higher solution, it's higher concentration to a region of its lower concentration. Make sure that you are able to understand. Yeah, so these are the four colligative properties that we need to understand. Then I said there are abnormalities in colligative properties coming up, whether we have electrovalent compounds or covalent compounds. Covalent compounds don't dissociate, electrovalent compounds dissociate. So when they dissociate, the number of particles change. So because number of particles change, again, the colligative properties change. So that is what we refer to as abnormal colligative properties. Wenthoff factor removed from your syllabus. So it won't come even in your entrance exams, it won't come. Yeah, next physical chemistry chapter. First thing is your Gopinath sir is back, so he'll be handling it. It will be electrochemistry. Yes, deleted even from JEE. Why the solute can't move? It's a semi-permeable membrane. The nature, the property of the membrane is it will not allow the solute particles to move. It will only allow the, that's why it is called a semi-permeable membrane. It will allow only the water particles to move. Yeah, move from lower concentration. Okay, so I explained the whole thing to you. Okay. Okay, good. So more problems. That's it. And then we are done. Sunday test. Okay, so I have no more tensions. Bye. See you. And we'll work hard.